Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining in today. We are broadcasting live from Tampa, Florida, and you can save your comments later for the Super Bowl. We can take those in the chat room if you want. San Diego, San Diego. And Kyle, where are you? San Diego also?
San Diego, that's correct. Yes.
So thank you, everybody, for joining in with us today and sharing your afternoon. I know you're all looking forward to hearing from our smart group today. I have to send a big shout out to my friend FX, who is the nexus of connectivity with Kyle and his partners here. Many of you may have seen the webinar we did for OSEARCH, the Ocean Conservation Group that I'm involved in with Chris Fisher, and FX sponsoring the expedition in Massachusetts. And so this is the nexus of connectivity and how I've got to know Fortis and Kyle and his partners. And so just want a big thank you to FX. Little Zoom housekeeping. Number one, we're recording this. So for whatever reason you want to go back and review it or share it with others, you're most welcome to do that. In a couple of days, it'll be up on the Family Office Insights YouTube channel. You can find that pretty easily by just saying that into Siri or something. And we're also welcome if you care to share this with anybody after you hear the presentation today. If it, and of course, the whole point today is to glean some interest from capable investors for the fund. And so if after listening to it today, you find that anybody that you know in your network might be interested in chatting and learning more about Fortis and Kyle and his partners, we're most welcome and encourage that. We also encourage right along questions. We'll get to as many as we can. We have a lot of people on the call today, but please feel free to, don't be bashful, send the questions in the Q&A and the chat box, and we'll be monitoring them and getting to as many as we can. Super happy to to suggest that David and Mike aren't stellar human beings, but I've learned that Kyle is, and so really, really happy to get to know him and what he's doing with this group, and you'll soon hear more about what he's doing. People who are doing very interesting things with the balance of their life, and so I'm gonna let you noodle about that for a minute. You'll find out about Kyle as well at another time. So with that, please feel free again to zip in your questions. We'll get as many as we can. Like I said, we have a lot of folks coming in, and we'll get and we'll address them as we go along. So again, welcome and thank you for being with us today. Kyle, you want to take it from there? You're on mute.
Yeah, thank you. I'd like to thank everyone else for joining us today. And FX, if you're watching, buddy, we love you. We appreciate you. And we're thinking about you. So as Arthur was saying, you know, David and Mike and I are grateful you are here. We're seeking a select family office as a fourth GP. And I'm going to explain a little bit about what we're doing. And then I'm going to turn over and introduce the team. And then David is going to explain our first fund and how we're executing it. It's pretty marvelous. So a little bit about me, like Arthur was saying, because some of you may be wondering how a Navy SEAL ended up here. A technologist and an entrepreneur, I have owned and operated businesses for the last 30 years while simultaneously serving our country as a Navy SEAL. And I recently retired as a Navy SEAL leader. And I had a wonderful, very rewarding career. And I was always able to secure the trust and confidence of the men and women that I served with. And, you know, during that time, I had the opportunity to conduct everything from single man missions all the way on three continents, all the way up to leading an 800 man combat operation and many jobs in between. And I concluded my career in charge of an advanced SEAL training command in preparation for important missions throughout the globe. I had around 235 military, 75 civilian employees. I had an annual operating budget of $110 million that I personally oversaw and managed. And I also oversaw procurement, delivery, and implementation of over $100 million in product and service contracts. And simultaneously, due to my tech and my entrepreneur background of operating civilian businesses over the years, I was fortunate enough to be hand-selected to lead several classified tech initiatives that have had global impacts over the years. One example was a classified global database that I oversaw the development, the implementation, the delivery of the product and services exceeding 50 million. And I got to be a part of a lot of many more innovative solutions for special forces. And so during my time on active duty, my passion really grew over the years into more endeavors. And I was a co-founder and oversaw a very successful nonprofit that serves disabled veterans. And that's where I met FX and eventually Arthur through that. And this endeavor and others have received extraordinary recognition in national media, in Manhattan, Fortune 500, including, you know, 60 Minutes, the CEO of Starbucks, Howard Schultz, to just name a few. And so, you know, when I was getting ready to retire from the SEAL teams, I was remembering back to my time overseas where I was saving American lives and impacting lives in multiple theaters around the world. And I really enjoyed doing that. I really did. And I knew that I wanted to continue to impact lives in a positive way. And so when David, Mike, and I came together, I really found a way to do that through FortisN. And Fortis, if you aren't aware, not to insult anyone's intelligence, but Fortis is the Latin root word for bravery and strength. And the letter N represents two very cool things to this team. It's often the certain number of patients that are represented within the healthcare industry, but it also really pays homage to our founding series of funds, the Nightingale series, which David is going to talk to about here shortly. David, next slide, please. And so, you know, our mission is really to produce uncommon returns by bringing speed to science for the sake of saving lives. And we're looking for a select family office or individual to be a part of this. As we look to save lives over the next decade and shift and move an industry, we really want to be partnered with a money partner of integrity to share and benefit from all lines of the business under FortisN. And you know, here's why. Next, we're seeking a $3 million investment for a 10% carry in returned equity on all business lines of the partnership. We have multiple funds on the horizon that are in sequence and support each other. And this is exclusive by design, meaning we do not intend to conduct more GP raises in the future. You know, similar to our LPs, we'll conduct a methodical capital call. We don't require all of this up front, but we'll get into that later. And we'll do capital calls for the remaining percentages over the next 12 to 24 months. That's preferred. And so next, over the next couple of years, we have more funds, as I mentioned, on the horizon. And this is our current timeline. We'll continue to sharpen these over the next couple of years as these funds, like I mentioned, are really in sequence and support each other. And they're part of our long-term strategy. And this is why we're really seeking a select office or individual to be part of this. We have a strong base. We have a strong foundation. What you're going to hear from David and Mike here in the future here momentarily. And so that's why we're really seeking a select individual to be part of this. So as Arthur mentioned, he mentioned me, but I couldn't do this by myself. Next, please, is we have a wonderful team. And I'm excited for you to get to meet both of them. So Mike, over to you, bud.
Thank you, Kyle. Yes, David, Kyle, and I agreed back in 2019 to work together on a single mission to help make people's lives better with faster approval and delivery of medications. Now, we had some similar career experiences that would assist our work. We're all military guys, as Kyle mentioned, who know how to trust and work together as a team. We each have experienced a number of high risk and high stress deployments to hotspots around the world, and we know how to tirelessly compete and win. And I think this is an essential value add, if you will, to demonstrate as a team, you know, our position in terms of being a success in the marketplace. Now, that description talks about how we are similar. What it was very appealing to me was how different we are in some very major areas. Each of the three have incredible skill sets and experience that complement each other. I'd say instead of 1 plus 1 plus 1 equals 3, it's 1 plus 1 plus 1 equals 10. For instance, my significant operating experience that makes the team stronger, faster, and better, I believe, comes from my career experience both in the private sector and in the public sector. I've been the CEO of two early stage tech companies where I've raised millions of dollars in private capital. So I've been on one side of the desk, the table, in boardrooms, engaging venture capitalists and private equity firms. I've also been the CEO of a Fortune 200 level tech company, which I formed while I was with Quest Communications, a joint venture with IBM, a $5 billion venture. While I was at Quest, I saw an opportunity for my 18-member team to form the corporate venture capital business unit in Quest. And I requested that we do that, and it was granted. The executive assistants of all the executive vice presidents, CEO, COO, and chairman loved the idea. And we took off with that and got approval for about $385 million to invest in select companies. They had to meet the important investment return metrics at the same way that they needed to meet our strategic needs in terms of developing new products and services. In parallel, as I mentioned, my team and I were we had the responsibility of landing strategic alliances and joint ventures with tier one and tier two companies that would generate $1 billion in revenue in years three through five. Now, I think this is important to us three because we expect to have the same kind of relationships in the boardrooms of big pharma and the federal government. And lastly, I have 3 decades plus of robust senior leadership experience in Washington, D.C., with the regulators, in program acquisition and large government contracting. So those are my highest and best use value adds to the partnership. And Kyle, I'll turn it back to you.
And it's my pleasure to introduce David Turner.
All right, great. So for most of my career, I've been an entrepreneur, an angel investor. I've sat on boards, and I had the fortunate opportunity with my last business named Parallel Six to build the business and pivot it into the life sciences space, specifically with clinical trials. And one of the things that I noticed with my last company was because of the regulatory nature of the space, there was a lack of venture funding. Over the course of 7 years, I raised about $12.5 million for the business. All of it, none of it was venture funding. And in 2017, I sold the business. And I had an opportunity to actually go out for a Series B round or sell the business. And I was struggling finding the right venture partner to fill out that Series B round. And so I decided to hire a banker. I sold the business for almost a 12x return on revenue. It was a SaaS-based company. And what we did was we sped up the clinical trial lifecycle. What came out of that experience was really a gap in the marketplace. And that gap was a venture fund that really helped growth stage businesses that are innovative technology businesses speed up science. And so as we were getting together and thinking about what to do next in our lives and our careers, what came forward was the need for, in this particular space, a $500 million pharma and health tech fund that was bookmarked for Series B growth stage innovative companies speed up science. And we decided to call the fund the Nightingale Fund after Florence Nightingale. The problem in the marketplace is that drug development is expensive and long. And when we first got into this, it was pre-COVID. And it was interesting because we got a lot of interest from a lot of people that we were talking to as we were testing the market, interviewing potential companies, interviewing potential LPs. And what we've determined over the years of being in this space is that the FDA is pretty darn efficient. The drug companies still primarily use 3-ring binders and fax machines. And the one thing that is key to speeding up drug development, this 10-year life cycle of getting a drug to market, sometimes costing $2 billion to get that drug to market. The one thing that can really impact and collapse those drug timelines and ultimately save lives around the world is innovative technology. Innovative technology that serves life sciences often has trouble raising growth capital because of the regulatory nature of the space. And as a result, VC funding is lacking due to the confusing and highly regulated market. So in order to fuel the innovation, tech companies need that strategic growth capital at a very specific stage of the growth cycle, the B round or the growth round. And what typically happens is you'll have a company that will raise $5 to $6 million in this market. And when they go out for that $15 to $20 million raise for the B round, they often struggle. Sometimes they struggle because the entrepreneur in charge of that company or the founder in charge of that company is a medical doctor, and they've never raised funds before. Sometimes it's an entrepreneur that is in conversations with a lot of private equity in this space, but because of the lack of EBITDA and because of the particular stage of the company, the private equity isn't able to come in. The innovation often gets curbed. These are just some examples. Parallel 6, the company that I founded, which was acquired by PRA Health Sciences, a $6 billion company in the industry, Drug Dev, Antidote, Monarch Bio. Some of these companies like Parallel 6, which was acquired by PRA, Drug Dev acquired by IQVIA, and others were basically acquired by large services companies like Arthur Anderson or Deloitte and Touche, et cetera. That's what PRA and IQVIA are to this particular industry. And when a services company takes on an innovation technology company, it's often a clash of two different philosophies. And what often ends up happening is the metrics of these very large publicly traded services companies don't fit with the metrics of how an innovative technology company moves over the course of time with their innovative life cycles. As a result, a lot of these innovative technology companies that get acquired are sometimes put in a box. Sometimes the technology is limited only to the clients of the services companies. And oftentimes the innovative cycle of the technology is slowed down or stifled to drive profits into that particular division of the business. In other cases, there are examples of companies like Monarch, where one of the head innovators in the entire space that worked at Genentech for multiple decades said that she was going to go and found her company. And she wasn't truly experienced and never raised money. And after raising $6 or $7 million for that kind of first seed Series A round, when she went out to look for Series B, the practices and the processes of raising that money wasn't really held on the executive team. And as a result, this company is now with great innovative technology in a box on the shelf, and the founders went on to full-time jobs again, hoping that someday it'll come off the shelf or possibly get sold and the innovation cycle will continue. So there's many more examples of this in the industry, but the way that we're solutioning our story is to start the Nightingale Fund number one. Like Florence Nightingale, it's time for us to have an impact on this particular space. It's time for us to produce uncommon returns while bringing drugs to market faster and ultimately saving lives around the world. We kind of sat back and we thought about, you know, how we can produce uncommon returns for our investors, specifically for the LP. And what showed up for us, which I think is unique to this space, is a strategic alignment with two organizations in this space. The first organization is an organization named Transcelerate. Transcelerate is an organization that was started by 20 of the largest pharma companies in the world. And this organization now has been in business for, I want to say, 11 or 12 years. But the entire mission of this organization is to basically write white papers on what specific innovative technology is needed to benefit the pharma space and the life sciences space and to collapse drug timelines and get drugs to market faster. The other organization that we're aligned to is called CRECO, Clinical Research as a Care Option. And what this basically means, this particular organization, what they're promoting is are patients who go into a hospital, and what they're promoting are innovative technologies that are available that allow doctors to say, hey, listen, you know, you have a chronic disease, or you have some other thing that we need to treat. And the typical treatment is, X, Y, or Z, but there are these clinical care options that are out there that are currently in phase 2 or phase 3 of clinical development. And we also have access to those drugs as well, and they may actually benefit you better. And so it's really pulling healthcare and pulling clinical operations and kind of that clinical trial life cycle together to benefit both the life sciences space as well as the patients that are going to the hospital and getting advice from their healthcare physicians. These two organizations have some very specific mission statements that we've adopted in order to strategically align with this space. The first one is to improve the patient and site experience. So we will look for innovative technology companies that map into improving the patient and site experience. We will also look for innovative technology companies that enhance sponsor or pharma efficiencies in drug safety throughout the clinical lifecycle. We will look for innovative technology companies that harmonize the overall process and promote the sharing of information between doctors, healthcare workers, patients themselves, and the industry as a whole. And this is really around data standards and other types of AI and machine learning. We'll also look for innovative technology companies that help to promote clinical research as a care option in healthcare, alerting doctors to different options, their healthcare professionals to different options that can benefit patients around the world. We're taking a global approach to finding these innovative technology companies that map into those core strategic principles. And the strategic alignment between these two organizations is with some of the top drug and pharma companies in the world. We believe that this is going to produce uncommon returns, both for our GP partner as well as for our LPs. And imagine this, running a venture fund where you closely align to an organization that's been put together by the industry that the fund is operating in, and finding innovative technology companies in that industry, funding them with $15 to $20 million of growth capital, and going back to these organizations and marketing out to some of the largest pharma companies on the planet that company XYZ is now funded by the Nightingale Fund and has the financial fitness to actually operate in the business and operate with seriousness and fulfill on the offer they're making to the marketplace. And imagine what happens when these large biopharma companies see that these companies are now well-funded and have the financial fitness to actually operate and fulfill on their clinical trials. And imagine how quickly the revenue of these organizations, these innovative technology companies, grow as a result. And imagine the M&A activity and the public activity of these companies and how quickly we can get these companies to a much higher enterprise value as a result and ultimately produce those uncommon returns. We have many different targets already in this industry. Because we're entrepreneurs for entrepreneurs, we know a lot of these people personally in the industry. We know these organizations in the industry already. And what we've done is we've just taken a moment to map some of these companies into the four different quadrants or the four different Nightingale principles that I spoke about on the previous slide. Now, remember, all of these Nightingale principles map into the mission of Transcelerate and of clinical research as a care option. And our deal flow over the next 1 to 2 years with these organizations is going to be plentiful. And because we know most of these individuals and we've come to know them and their organizations, and they know us as entrepreneurs in the industry who are doing this for the sake of entrepreneurship and innovation, we think that we have an uncommon opportunity to impact the industry, help to grow these companies with our investments, and produce uncommon returns across the board.
David?
Again, yes.
May I interrupt just for 1 second? Would that be okay?
Yes.
the two organizations that you're adhering to the principles, would it be fair to say mm-hmm. that the companies that are likely to exit the companies that you're investing in not only funded these consortiums, and I'm going to use a long word, but they're paying attention, and what their white papers are saying, they give credence to. So if you solve the problem that the white paper says that exists, then the companies that will likely exit the companies you're investing in are actually paying attention and give credence to what they say.
That's exactly right. And it goes a step farther. When those white papers are produced, on the board of Transcelerate in particular, there are 20 representatives from the largest pharma companies in the world that sit on the board of Transcelerate. So not only is the team at Transcelerate writing these white papers and talking about the innovation that's needed in the industry, but the 20 members of the board who are executive vice presidents in most cases from the largest pharma companies in the industry are actually ratifying and agreeing and agreeing to publish those white papers saying, yes, this is actually what's needed in the industry to speed up science, collapse our drug timelines, get drugs to market faster, and save lives and improve lives around the world. We believe that because we're mapping the companies into those white papers and into that particular mission of Transcelerate, these companies will have an incredible amount of business to be had from those large pharma companies that are members of Transcelerate, because we will be working with Transcelerate to actually market to those pharma companies that are members of Transcelerate, that these companies now have the financial fitness and now have the proper type of investment to actually fulfill on their offers to the marketplace. And we believe it's going to speed up revenue cycles, which will vastly increase enterprise value and allow these companies to grow a lot faster than otherwise.
Great. So excellent. So I tend to oversimplify things because I don't get into the details, thankfully.
Sure.
So the problems that are clearly identified by a credible source, you're going to solve, and the companies that are waiting to buy those companies that solve those problems are all in alignment.
That's exactly right. There's alignment between the innovative technology companies, what the industry is saying it needs, and the Nightingale Fund to fund those companies so that they can actually service that industry.
Excellent. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there's a couple things that always get asked. You know, do you have enough deal flow in the industry to actually invest $500 million worth of funding in the Nightingale Fund? And the answer there is yes. The second question that's asked is, do you have access to those companies or that deal flow? And do you know those companies? And the answer there is yes, because we're in the industry. It's a very small and close-knit industry with very large dollars behind it, as you know. The third question that's asked is, you know, if you do put investment into these companies, how does the revenue cycle and how does the enterprise value cycle show up? How does your investment help these companies to grow? And with the alignment with Transcelerate and CRACO, Clinical Research as a Care Option, and the fact that all the pharma companies are already behind these two very large initiatives in the industry, tells us that with that alignment between the deal flow, these industry initiatives, and the pharma companies themselves, what it does is everything is leading towards rapid revenue growth post-funding and rapid enterprise value growth post-funding, which will ultimately lead to benefiting the industry, all benefiting the GP and the LPs of Fortis and partners by having a lot of faster M&A activity and higher valued M&A activity and even some public events along the way. So again, we invest in that Series B and Series C kind of growth capital area. We're doing this to de-risk the overall fund. We believe that if we're focusing on innovative technology companies that are between $3 to $5 million in revenue and or have $15 million in contract value, that's going to be the sweet spot. What often happens because of the size of these contracts is that you'll have an innovative technology company that will get 4 to 5 or 6 clients And just with that handful of clients, we'll have anywhere between $10 and $20 million in contract value, booking revenue ratably along the way, or maybe there's one-time setup fees that drive $3 to $5 million of revenue. And at that point, they're normally going for that growth capital. So again, for the Nightingale Fund 1 structure, the size is $500 million. We are looking for LP commitments for a minimum of $10 million. It's a it's a 10-year fund. It's a 2-on-20 structure. And we're going to be looking at primarily having LP capital come from corporate venture funds. We believe that, and through our Transcelerate partnership, by the way, we believe that Transcelerate is going to help us get in front of corporate venture funds at Pfizer and Novartis and Roche and some of these others. And we believe that through that relationship and with the alignment of Transcelerate, we'll be able to raise a lot of the LP funding from these corporate venture groups at the large pharma companies, simply for the sake of benefiting the space. We've even had conversations with Transcelerate where Transcelerate has talked about, as we start getting things going, they've talked about possibly raising money from their members and having a Transcelerate investment as an LP, which we think would be very interesting and very validating as well. We think that with the corporate venture funds coming in, a lot of what will follow will be other kind of traditional LPs to fill out the entire $5 million round. And as we were thinking about this, we thought about how difficult it is for a Pfizer fund or a Novartis fund to invest in any one of these innovative technology companies. Because of the competitive nature of the space, it would be like a Walmart fund investing in a data science company. If a Walmart fund invested in a data science company, that data science company would never get Target or Best Buy or any other retailer that competed with Walmart as a client. And so what Fortis and Partners is going to provide for this space, in addition to the uncommon returns for our LPs, is it's going to provide an option for these corporate venture funds at the different pharma companies to actually be able to invest into the Nightingale Fund and through that into innovative technology companies to further activate what Transcelerate has been doing for over a decade now. We believe that for our general partner coming in with us, the lifetime potential of investment is considerable on the initial $3 million that comes in. We are expected to probably invest in about 20 companies with about $20 million of investment per company. We have some conservative and some desired number of exits and some value to those exits. We think that those returns continue to grow as we move through Nightingale Funds 2 through 5. And we do think that these strategic partners and additional follow-on funding is going to further produce returns for the strategic GP partner that we're looking for here today. So with that, I'd like to turn it back over to Kyle to speak about and go back through some of the unfair advantages that we have in the marketplace. And Kyle, I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, bud. Mike, you're up next, buddy. We do believe, before I turn it over to you, Mike, is that we have some unfair advantages. And thank you, David, for that. We believe that together, the three of us and our powerful allies, our deal flow, our experience is quite incredible. Mike, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Kyle. Yeah, I think what we what we've done is demonstrate that from A to Z, we three have an incredible corpus of experience. We understand the financial metrics like a CFA would. We also understand through our experience how to engage very large companies in the boardroom, and of course, engage with the regulators and those who issue contracts and so forth in DC. From small business capturing capital, persuading venture capitalists, we've done that. And that experience allows us to be entrepreneurs for entrepreneurs. We secure confidence in those entrepreneurs to know that we're part of the team. We have a lot of confidence, but we also have a lot of humility as a result of our life experiences, including myself. And I always hearken back to some of my own experiences that I learned from, which you know, got me into some trouble, but I was able to work out of it, and I don't make those mistakes again. A lot of VCs in our experience don't have the operational experience that we three have. And we think a fourth general partner would be a marvelous add to our suite. So back to you, Kyle. The list of unfair advantages, I think, you know, pulls all that together.
You're here. Yeah, and next, Dave. So we that brings us to our close, Arthur. We're going to leave this up just to make sure that everyone can gather the information. Please, if you are interested to learn more, please give us a call, shoot us an email. We'd love to learn from you. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to share more with you. But we'll leave that up, Arthur, as we you know, take some Q&A.
Yeah, if you could profile as that GP person that you're looking for, what skills, aside from check writing capabilities, would that look like? Because can you build the profile of the ideal candidate? You, and I didn't mean to surprise you because I didn't tell you I was going to ask that question. But
it's all good.
Do your
best. David, you want to take this one?
Sure. Yeah, we've thought about this a lot. We've thought about whether or not we get several kind of individual investors to build out our team, or whether or not we look for a strategic partner in terms of a family office or maybe a fund that wants to be part of this fund. For us, we're looking for somebody who's sophisticated, somebody who is interested in this space, somebody who's aligned with us, not only to gain a return, because that's first and foremost on their investment, but also work in a space where the altruistic abilities are there, maybe for the first time. I mean, for a lot of venture funds and a lot of GPs, you know, it's all about
ROI.
Producing a return and ROI. But in this space, imagine how great it is to have an opportunity to produce an uncommon return because of the alignment of how we're looking at this, but also to talk about the impact that we're having in this space. I mean, our goal is first and foremost to produce uncommon returns for our LPs and for our GP partners. But a very close second is to impact the space over the next 10 years in a positive way, bring speed to science, and get people around the world who need access to drugs, access to those drugs through our investments and through innovative technology. And imagine what a story that is, and what it means to be a part of something like that. And we're looking for a strategic partner who sees that vision and who can execute inside of that vision alongside of us.
Dave, one of your early slides, you articulated or pointed out three things that get in the way of what normally happens for things to be successful. And I think the second one was the innovation, and the innovation is thwarted because of lack of capital, or is it thwarted because the acquirer just has a very specific use for that technology that accelerates another part of their business?
It's a little bit of both, and I'll give you a very specific example of this. And it's still like this today, when I started Parallel 6 and we moved into the life sciences space, it's such a highly regulated space that if you don't price your product high enough, they look at you and say, are you sure this is going to work? Are you sure it's fully validated software? So I've experienced that. And what's unique about this industry that I learned very quickly is when a billion-dollar drug manufacturer is spending billions of dollars on one particular drug and over the course of 10 years to get that drug to market, and they're going to even consider using innovative technology to speed up that life cycle, they require you as a vendor to produce a financial fitness report. And imagine me producing a financial fitness report that says, you know, we're going to do $4 million this year. We're going to burn $2 million this year. And we have about $1.5 million in the bank. Imagine the conversation that I'm in with them. Well, are you going to be around for the next 3 years for this phase three clinical development? And is your software going to continue to work? And where are you going to get the other money? Because I'm looking at your burn and your return, and I see a gap there. And my only comeback was, well, you know, we're trying to raise more at all times. Trust me. And think about the difference in that conversation where you say, you know what, we're at $4 million in revenue, we're burning $2 million a year, but we have $20 million worth of growth capital from the Nightingale Fund in our bank, and we're going to use that to grow our company to a profitable business and continue to build the innovation cycle to benefit you as a client. That's a whole different conversation. So that's first and foremost. The second conversation that happens is after an acquisition. And most of the acquisitions, in our case at Parallel 6, it was a premature acquisition because of the lack of funding in the space. When we got acquired, one of the first things that happened by the acquiring company was they said, we will not allow you to sell your innovative technology to anybody in the space unless they are already clients of ours. Now, from a services company perspective, that's a very smart business decision, but it doesn't benefit the space. It doesn't benefit life sciences and pharma as a whole, and it stifles the innovation cycle because all of a sudden we are pigeonholed in these very specific engagements that are only specific to their clients, and our innovation cycle ground to a halt, and that actually harms the space. And so by keeping these companies independent and operating and growing longer allows them to have larger M&A activity, larger deals in the M&A side. It also gives them an opportunity to find a path to an IPO, which continues our innovative cycle and continues to benefit the space over time while producing uncommon returns for the venture teams that actually get in there and invest through that growth.
That totally makes sense. So making the technology proprietary to one provider, one service provider, limits the revenue growth and limits the ability to affect a larger population. I get it, right?
Yep, exactly.
Is there, without disclosing things you shouldn't or don't want to talk about, the two organizations, and forgive me, that
Transcelerate and Craco, yes.
Are they even candidates to be in the fund, or was it a conflict of interest? Or I know you mentioned a little bit of that earlier. Is that something that's a discussion underway, if you can talk about it?
I can talk about it, and I'll be careful about how I talk about it because I don't want to get out over the front of my skis here. Yeah. Craco is not an organization that that will ever be able to invest, I say that, in Fortisyn. And the reason why is because it's an organization that's primarily made up of healthcare providers and others that are trying to promote this clinical research as a care option in the industry. However, Transcelerate is an organization that basically is made up of all the pharma companies in the world. And those pharma companies pay dues. And there was, and we've had conversations with the head of Transcelerate on multiple occasions now. And our message to Transcelerate is, you know, you've been writing white papers for the better part of a decade. We are going to activate your organization and those white papers through our investments. And one of the options that we produced for them that they said might be a viable option is raise your dues to your pharma companies for the sake of getting an additional $50 million worth of dues from the pharma companies and investing that $50 million into the Nightingale Fund One so that you can participate in activating what you've been doing for the last decade. And that was a very interesting first conversation to them.
Very clever, yeah. Mm-hmm. My friend Pete Thurlow is on the call. He's a stellar human being and the best IP attorney in the world, just so you know. And his comment is that, and it may be precipitated by my question, that J&J is not going to necessarily invest in the fund, but maybe they will.
Novartis, J&J, and other corporate VCs are highly aligned to invest in companies and startups that are specific to science. So for instance, if there is a company that has one or two drugs that are in phase one or phase two, and maybe those drugs are curing breast cancer, that is something that corporate venture funds will look at and bookmark an investment into to continue to promote that science, usually with a first option to purchase at some point. What they're not experienced in and what they're not really equipped to do is to evaluate innovative technology companies that speed up that process. And what often they're not equipped to do is not only to evaluate, but also are not equipped to invest in those companies because the founders often are nervous that if they get an investment from J&J, that tech company will not be able to sell to GSK or to Eli Lilly or to Novartis or any of those other J&J competitors, because if J&J has a board seat or two, those competitors are not going to put their clinical trial data in this highly competitive landscape with a technology company where there's a J&J representative sitting on the board, especially if there are competing drugs.
Yeah, totally makes sense.
Yeah.
Kyle, as you mentioned, you've kept this page up here, and for the benefit of everybody there, we're going to make sure that the folks on the presentation here get your information, the registration information. So we'll put everybody in touch for sure. I will repeat, and if it's okay with you guys, that if there, as a result of listening to this, is there anybody that you think our guests should speak to, we encourage that, as is always the case, almost always. Family Office Insights is not standing in the way. You feel free to contact Kyle and company directly. You don't need to keep us in the loop and worry about us getting paid, because that's not what we do here, and most everybody knows that. So feel free to connect directly with them for yourselves and anybody else that you think might benefit from knowing them. We're gonna wrap it up a little bit here. You guys wanna go one at a time with a little closing statement?
Yeah, again, just to add on to that, Arthur, if any of you want to just email us, drop us a note, we were more than happy to do a follow-up call or just a Zoom to just talk through some things. Thank you all for being here. Very, very appreciative. Mike, to you, bud.
Yeah, I concur. Thank you, Arthur, for coordinating this, and thank you for all of those who are out there and attended. It's our pleasure to communicate our story, and we hope that it has inspired you.
Excellent.
Yeah, appreciate it. Arthur, thank you for putting this together. For the attendees, this is a great opportunity for a sophisticated strategic investor who's aligned with our story and aligned with our vision to get in on the ground floor with something that's going to be really special over the coming decades. And we look forward to hearing from you if there's any interest from anybody out there.
Awesome. Stellar team, folks. And really, really appreciated learning more through this and getting to know you guys. And Kyle, super cool. And as I often say, thank you all. Family Office Insights community has been super awesome. And thank you all for spending the only thing you can't make more of, and that's your time with us today. Till next time, thanks.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye-bye.